Diciamo apura canu, apurai tightnut, neye akanfo nanazon da, medinde ojirafo, kwesi rane buta akan. Akwamumayana maruka etifi mu ojirafo, ojiramayan mu. Greetings to all apura kani, apurai tighty people, many African black people today. Akanfo nanazon day, ancient authentic akan ancestral religion day. My name is Ojirafo Kwesi Ranehmputa Akan, Ojirafo of the Akwamu Nation in North America within Ojirama, the purified nation, Apurakani, Apuraikaiti people in the Western Hemisphere. Yet I say we thank you once again for tuning in to the broadcast. We're opening up the chat room right now. As the chat room is opening up, if you have a question or a comment on the phone line, hit the number one so that we can see that your hand is raised. If you have a question or a comment in the chat room as we open it up, you must log in as a user in order to interact in the chat room. If you don't have a username, you can sign up for one quickly in BlogTalk so that you can interact. All right, and the chat room is coming up now. For individuals who are new to the broadcast, we have four broadcasts on a weekly basis, ancient, authentic, Akan, ancestral religion on Joda on Monday night. We deal specifically with the Akan expression of ancestral religion, firstly, because we are Akan, secondly, because of the misinformation propagated regarding Akan philosophy, culture, cosmology, the nature of Nyamewa and Nyame, the great mother and the great father, the supreme being, the nature of Nyonkumpong and Nyonkumtong, the creator and creatress, grandchildren of the supreme being, the nature of the Apostong, the deities, the Nananong, and Samanfo, the spiritually cultivated ancestresses and ancestors, as well as our cosmology, ritual practices, and so forth. So we deal with that, and we deal with it from an ancestrally inherited, authentic perspective. Akan people migrated from ancient Kanat, which is a title of ancient Nubia. The Khan Empire migrated to the western part of the continent, reestablished the Khanat Empire, or the quote-unquote Nubian Empire, in the western part of the continent a couple of thousand years ago after the fall of ancient Kemet. Hundreds of years later, some of our people migrated from that region of West Afuraka, Afuraikai, further south towards the forest belt to the regions of contemporary Cote d'Ivoire and Ghana, to reestablish Akana civilization hundreds of years ago, about 1,000 years ago. And then hundreds of years later, some of our people were taken from that region in the Forest Belt region, forced during the Musuo Kessie, the Great Diversity, the enslavement era, into North, Central, South America, the Caribbean, and Europe during the enslavement era. This is how people from ancient Kana, so-called Nubia and Kemet, migrated to the western part of the continent, continued the culture, and some of us ended up in the Western Hemisphere still practicing Akan ancestral religion. We show that, and we deal with various texts, oral, ritual, and so forth from the Akan tradition, and dealing with the Abosom divinities and so forth. We also focus on Hoodoo as well in many of these broadcasts, because Hoodoo is the Akan tradition in North America. So we're going to get into detail about that. On Ojira, the broadcast Ojira, which is on Benada, Abenada Tuesday night, we have Ojira, which means purification. We deal with ancestral religion, Afurakani, Afuraikani, African ancestral religion in general, not just the Akan expression, but wherever we exist in the world, ancestral religion and how it impacts every aspect of our lives. It's not just something that we engage in on a periodic basis, and then go about our everyday lives, and then go back once a week or once every other week to do something, quote-unquote, spiritually religious. We deal with ancestral religion, the ritual incorporation of divine law and the ritual restoration of divine vows. That means through ritual, we incorporate those things, objects, deeds, and entities we need to incorporate in order to align our thoughts or incorporate thoughts, intentions, and actions in harmony with divine order. And through ritual, we reject those things, objects, deeds, and entities we need to reject, to repulse, to hate, in order to restore balance to our thoughts, intentions, and actions, and thus restore balance to our lives, to realign ourselves with divine order. So ancestral religion, Nana Son, which is a catch-all term for ancestral religion, Afurakani, or African ancestral religion, is the ritual incorporation of divine law and the ritual restoration of divine balance. Through purification, Ojida, which means purification. Purification operationalizes Nana Son. Purification, Ojida, operationalizes our ritual incorporation of law and the ritual restoration of balance, the expansive and contractive poles of ancestral religion. We seek to align every thought, every intention, every action, every moment of every day with divine order. This is Afurakani, Afurakani culture, our way of life, the divine acceptance, the law, the love of order, and the divine rejection, hatred, repulsion of disorder and its purveyors. That's our culture. We seek to incorporate law and restore balance every moment of every day. We have ritual practices to assist us in that process, including when we make mistakes, we can realign ourselves with order ritually so that we can stay on track with our culture, the divine acceptance of order, the divine rejection of disorder. So this is what we deal with on Tuesday night, Abinada, Binada, which is the Ojira broadcast. On Awukuda, Akuada, Wednesday night, we have Egua Marketplace. We showcase businesses, organizations, and institutions in the Afurakani, Afurakani community who are serving our people in a positive capacity, who also maintain their ancestral religious values in the process, and those ancestral religious values in their service to the community. So we've had a number of businesses, organizations, and institutions who have come onto the show, sat with us for 2 hours to speak about their organizations and businesses and institutions and their philosophy of service, rooted in divine order, rooted in their ancestral religious values. And part of that process, when we're dealing with Ekua Marketplace, we have published the work, Okom Economic Development Model. That is an economic development model rooted in our ancestral religious values. So therefore, it is a holistic approach to economic development rooted in our culture, rooted in our ancestral religious values. We published that document. You can download that document from our Okom Economic Development Model page. We'll put that link in the chat room real quick. You can download the model, the four-part series we did where we examined the model and its application. And you'll also see the list of businesses, organizations, and institutions, their websites that we've been supporting on a weekly basis. It's a growing list, part of the Okom Economic Development Model process. Operation strategy is to starve the beast and feed the frog. That means on a weekly basis, you make a determination on what funds you would have potentially wasted with the whites and their offspring at their businesses. And then you starve the beast and feed the frog. You reallocate those funds away from those white businesses and direct them to the business, organization, or institution of the week. We are targeting one Afurakani, Afurakani business, organization, or institution per week for 52 weeks for capital infusion at an optimal level. That means when you starve the beast and feed the pride and you take the $10 or $15 you would have wasted at Chipotle or Walmart or any other business, white business, and you direct that $10 or $15 to the business of the week, that's an infusion of $10 or $15. When 1,000 of our people engage that process, that's an infusion of $10,000 to $15,000 into a black business in the course of 7 days, which allows them to serve us at a greater capacity. They can now provide the products and services we were receiving from the white businesses. They have the funds to serve us in that capacity. They also have the funds immediately to hire black people to work full-time within their business, simply from us transferring our resources from the white businesses directly to ours within the course of 1 week. We've caused and allowed this business to expand, to serve us at a greater capacity, and to hire black people within the business instantaneously, permanent hire. We engage that process. so that's a win-win situation across the board. They can expand their products, expand their services, expand their businesses to serve more black people and take that business away from our enemies, the whites and offspring, and run them out of our communities. If we do not engage this process and make that seed the prize, then we leave those funds, that $10,000 to $15,000, in the hands of our absolute enemies, the whites and offspring, and their perverse businesses. And therefore, we are feeding them and financing our own oppression by default. So we must make that decision on a weekly basis to starve the beast and feed the pride, reallocate those funds away from white businesses, and support the business organization or institution of the week. When you go to the Ocom Economic Development Model page on our website, you will see the list of businesses we've been supporting, and that list, as we said, will continue to grow. And you can go directly to the business of the week. You can make your contribution or purchase from that business to support that business, reallocate those funds. And then we on Yada Thursday, Yada Abada, we have a Mind STEM Affairs of the Nation, where we focus on specific issues that are affecting Ojirama, the purified nation in the Western Hemisphere, Afurakani people in the Western Hemisphere, and how we address these issues to bring balance to our community so we can move forward harmoniously without being self-destructive. So these are the four broadcasts. We're going to put some links in the chat room real quick, dealing with the information that we're going to deal with tonight. You go to the publications page on the website, you can download the link to our book, Who Do People? I'll deal with that. First, as we're getting started, we want to say, Yedase, we thank you to everyone who came out to our Ojiramai Afashe, purified nation of Afurakani, Afurakani people in the Western Hemisphere conference festival. This was our first Ojiramai Afashe, Ojiramai conference. Of course, Ojiramai means Ojira, purified, pure, Omine nation. Mine West, land of the setting sun. Ojiramai is the purified nation of Afurakani, Afurakani people in the Western Hemisphere, the land of the setting sun. There's Afurakani, Afurakani people in North, Central, South America, the Caribbean, descendants of those who were forced into enslavement during the Umusuo Ketie, the Great Perversity, the enslavement era, who waged war against the whites and offspring to free ourselves from enslavement, to massacre the whites and offspring and establish our independent sovereign territories, and forced through warfare, forced the civil war to take place. We forced the acceptance of abolition, forced the acceptance of emancipation by waging war against the whites and offspring. So we had our Ojiramai conference focusing on Amaniye, Afurakani, Afurakani, African Black nationism, the purification of nationalism. This is our first conference, Ojiramai conference. This is an annual conference, so we have three annual conferences yearly, of course. The Hoodoo Mind, Hoodoo Nation Festival, dealing with the Akan ancestry religion in North America in October, 3 weeks after the autumn Asimet, or fall equinox. Then in March, around the spring equinox, we have Echisain, ancestral religious reversion, dealing with our ancestrally inherited religious traditions born of the blood circles of our people here in the Western Hemisphere, Hoodoo, the Akan tradition, Juju, the Yoruba tradition in North America, Vodun, the Fonan Ebe tradition in North America, Grigri, the Bambara tradition in North America, Wanga, the Ovambo, Bella tradition in North America, Ngangai, the Fang tradition in North America, the various traditions we have maintained in our blood circle, our divinatory practices, those traditions that supported our liberation movements and the success of those liberation movements through warfare, we maintain and give information about these traditions. So that's Echisain around the spring equinox. And then at the apex of the year, the summer solstice, around that time, we have Ojiramai Afashe, purified nation Aotearoa Kaini and Whakaini people in the Western Hemisphere, a conference specifically for Ojirama and the Purified Nation, dealing with nationism, Amaniye, the purification of nationalism. So we had great presentations, Ia Ajua. We're going to be posting that. We're also going to be posting the video submission sent by Enna Njideka Carmo, which is, she was one of the businesses of the week, so with Dr. Ia Ajua in the past. Dr. Ia Ajua with her Wahimi Mesu cultural productions and so forth, and then Enna Njideka Carmo with Babo Hugie Suya, Pan-African Online Educational Co-op Classes, educational institution online. So she's going to be, we're going to be posting that submission of her presentation on the YouTube channel as well as, the regular website, Dr. Ia Ajua's presentation, then the presentation that we did on Amaniye, nationism, the purification of nationalism, and also dealing with the Per Ankh Nut and Akura whole life intervention, and how that Per Ankh Nut cosmogram dealing with self-governance and the governance of the Afurakani Afurakaidi nation from the perspective of nationism, a nationist approach to governance. We're going to post clips from that presentation as well. So that will be coming up later this week. So again, Yedase, we thank everyone who came out. It was a great event. We had our Egua Marketplace. We had our vendors there. People were able to shop throughout the course of the day. It was an all-day event, including raw, live, natural foods provided by Enna Essie's Kitchen. We had great vendors. Everyone appreciated the vendors, supported the vendors, appreciated the presentations. The question and answer sessions were very rich, very important, great information that was exchanged, given, and received. So, we appreciate that very much, and we will be posting more information. You'll see on Facebook, people have been posting pictures from the event, some clips of video from the event, so that's going to continue. And then we'll let everybody know when we post the information, the actual presentation up on YouTube as well as the regular website. All right. So, topic for tonight, Joe Akan, origin of the ring shout in hoodoo. Now, this is part of, as we said, Akanfo Nanason, ancient authentic Akan ancestry legends. Hoodoo is the Akan tradition in North America. Until we prove the actual etymology of the term hoodoo, the white canary spring has been putting forth false information, trying to say that hoodoo came from the Irish term, talking about rock formation, talking about it came from Hudio or Judeo or Judaism and so forth, all that kind of nonsense. We have proven irrefutably that the term hoodoo is the term undu from the Akan language, dealing with medicine from roots, trees, bark, and so forth, stumps and so forth, plant life. This is root medicine, undu. Undu also means to become heavy with the spirit, conjuring the spirit. So when we talk about hoodoo and conjure being the titles of our tradition in North America, these were Akan-speaking people bringing the terms hoodoo or undu into North America, dealing with root work, root workers, root doctors, and so forth. We also use the term in Akan, kanche. Ka means to speak, to utter, to say, to tell, to pray. Che means to bring forth the spirit, as in the coming forth of the rising sun, the energy of the rising sun, that spiritual force emerging. That's what Che is talking about. So Kanche means to utter incantations, to bring forth the spirit. That's an Akan term. We've also shown in our article called Kanche how the term Ka in ancient Kemet, found written in the Medutu, the so-called hieroglyph. Ka means to speak, to utter a sound, to pray, to tell, and so forth. It also, and Che also means the coming forth of the sun, and the actual Medu hieroglyphic symbol is the emerging, rising sun above the horizon. So just as Ka in Che means to speak, utter, pray, invoke ritually, to bring forth the spirit, as in the bringing forth of the energy of the sun in ancient Kemet. Kanche means the exact same thing in the Akan language today. And we continue to say Kanche when we came into North America. Kanche, meaning to bring the spirit forth through ritual invocation. We said Kanche and became pronounced Kanche. The whites in our offspring thought we were saying conjure, C-O-N-J-U-R-E, conjure, conjuring spirits and so forth. We were saying Kanche, as we have been saying for thousands of years. We're also saying Ndu, talking about root medicine, root work, root doctors and so forth, and becoming heavy with the spirit to bring the spirit down. So hoodoo and conjure being the name of our religious practice in North America, the Akan religious practice, are the exact same names we have used in Akan culture for thousands of years, going all the way back to ancient Kanat and Kemet, so-called Nubian Egypt. So we have proven that conclusively in our book, Hoodoo People, Afro Akanu, Afro Akainu, in North America, Akan custodians of hoodoo from ancient hoodoo Ndunu land, Kanit Dubi. And then we've also published Hoodoo Mind, the Hoodoo Nation Journal. We have more information there. And then we published our book, Etchy Sign, Ancestral Religious Reversion. And we have more information there as well. We've also published other articles and so forth dealing with this information. We're going to go into some specific information about this notion of shouting or the ring shout ritual, sacred ritual dance and so forth in the hoodoo tradition. Once we go through this information, you will be able to see that this is just one more example of Akan religious practice in North America that can be identified specifically as the Akan tradition. There are many Afurakani Afurakani groups who dance in counterclockwise circles. But when you see the preponderance of the evidence, and of course, people who are engaged in the ritual practice, we know who our Akan ancestors and ancestors are, and we still speak that language. They still speak that language to us, so they will show us directly. But we have shown conclusively through etymological origins, cosmological origins, ritual practices, and so forth, that these things are directly Akan, and we can trace them to the Akan tradition, the exact same terms and ritual practices in ancient Kemet with the exact same name, exact same meaning in the Mendu through the hieroglyphs that they have in the Akan language today, and that they also still have exact same definitions in the hoodoo religion in North America. When we were brought over here, we continued to speak our language, continued to use our terminology, continued to engage our ritual practice. It would only be much later, in the so-called 1800s and into the 1900s, that the term hoodoo became misappropriated and simply used as a, on one hand, a derogatory term by the whites in their offspring, on the other hand, a catch-all term for anything Afurakani, Afurakani, or African. They'll say, well, they're into that hoodoo, those Africans, they're into that hoodoo. And it became utilized or misused as an interchange with voodoo and juju and so forth. But Vodou comes from the Fon and Ewe language, the Fon and Ewe speaking people who were enslaved, forced into enslavement in North America. They continue to use the term Vodou or Voodoo. Juju is a Yoruba word. Those who were Yoruba forced into North America, they continue to call their Yoruba tradition by a Yoruba name, which is Juju. Akan people were forced into North America. We continue to use the Akan term Hoodoo, Ndu, Hoodoo to refer to our Akan tradition. The same with the Grigri amongst the Bambara people. That is their term and their language, and they continue to use that exact same term to identify their religious practice. The Ovambo people become part of the Gullah constellation of Afurakani, Afurakani people. They're enslaved. They continue to use the term Wanga as a designation for their ancestral religious tradition, as they did on the continent, and the term Wanga continues to be used today that was originally coming from and so forth, an ethnic group. So we have put forward a great number or great deal of information proving this in numerous ways. We've talked about the Ndu Akuaba, the hoodoo doll baby, proving that the Akuaba doll in the Akan tradition is the hoodoo doll baby. We talked about the term Kanche as conjure. We talked about the term haint, the spirit, the haint. Those spirits who are kind of aggressive and aroused, that comes directly from the term kinti in the icon tradition, meaning aroused, and when it's dealing with spirits, talking about those aroused, aggressive spirits, the hinti. This is where the term hink comes from, that sacred hink blue. That blue color is sacred, and we went into detail about that in a broadcast. We talked about the moja and edja in icon, where you get the mojo and the jack ball or jock. So you have mojo and jock in the hoodoo tradition, the ritual amulet. You have the moja and edja in icon, ritual amulets from the Patrick clan and Magic clan deity and ancestral spirit. We did a broadcast in detail about that. So whether you're talking about mojo, jock or jock ball, whether you're talking about hate spirit, kanche or conjure, hoodoo undo itself, the hoodoo doll baby, a number of different aspects of traditional culture, hoodoo culture, we are proving that these are specific icon expressions. Our work is the first to prove that and give the actual cultural foundation for hoodoo. Of course, there are many things that are shared by Afro-Aikani people wherever we exist in the world because we're fundamentally similar. But there are specific, nuanced expressions of culture that every ethnic group possesses and manifests. And the hoodoo tradition is that manifestation of Akan tradition. So, and you'll find all throughout the hoodoo vocabulary, Akan term, ritual practices, and so forth. Sacred colors, and so forth. Now, we're going to get into a couple of things. First, what is the ring shout in and of itself? When you see, and you can go on YouTube and download Google ring shout or ring shout dance. You see there are a number of groups who are preserving the ring shout dance and having different demonstrations of the ring shout dance and so forth, whether it's in South Carolina or Georgia, different places. Then some people still practice hoodoo, and you'll see that ring shout dance that is a religious ritual practice. It is a ritual practice to invoke the abosom, invoke the deity, evoke the nananom samanfo, the spiritually cultivated ancestresses and ancestors through ritual dance. Ritual dance, just like ritual song or ritual prayer and ritual other ritual incantations, are gateways to the spirit realm. So for example, when you engage in ritual song, you're singing, those sound vibrations begin to reverberate, they become magnetic, they draw the ancestresses and ancestors to you, they come both of them to you. Those sound vibrations open you up as well and propel you into the spirit realm. It's a gateway to the spirit realm. People engage in ritual dance, generating a kind of vortex of energy, propelling themselves into the spirit realm, opening that gateway. Ritual prayer. Various forms of ritual are gateways to the spirit realm. Now, this ring shout that we engage in, dancing in a counterclockwise circle, singing, call and response, singing, chanting, stomping and so forth, clapping. This is a specific, the manner in which it's done is a specific Akan expression. Moving in a counterclockwise circle, the call and response, the specific syncopation of the footwork, the stutter step footwork, you will find that in the hoodoo tradition. When you look at people who are engaged in ritual practice in Ghana as well as Ivory Coast, the Akom dance, when people go through Akom or spirit possession, they dance around in a counterclockwise circle. They have the same call and response, clapping and so forth, but then they also have the same syncopated stutter step footwork as they glide around the circle. It's different than, for example, you see in certain Yoruba practices or Vodun, you may see people dancing in a line, being possessed by the Abosom or the Orisha, the Vodou, the Egungun, Kubidu, and so forth, or dancing in like a square block of people, and then the priest or priestesses in the front and so forth. In the Akan tradition, we're moving around in a counterclockwise circle, a specific syncopated footwork pattern that is unique, and you will see that in North America. You will also see that people separated by thousands of miles and hundreds of years engaged in the exact same footwork, the exact same direction counterclockwise, the exact same call and response, clapping and so forth, in the midst of that ritual practice, and then the possessions take place. Spirit possession, spirit communication. Now, we want to give definitions because the whites and offspring, of course, will misinform and try to take these traditions out of our own practice. So, for example, if you want to find out something about ring shout and you Google ring shout, you see Wikipedia to say a shout or ring shout is an ecstatic transcendent religious ritual first practiced by African slaves in the West Indies and the United States, in which worshipers move in a circle while shuffling and stomping their feet and clapping their hands. Despite the name, shouting aloud is not an essential part of the ritual. The ring shout was practiced in some African-American churches into the 20th century, and it continues to the present among the Gullah people of the CI. Now, they're already starting off with some misinformation. Yes, we move in a circle. It's not shuffling and stomping feet, but it's a specific syncopated rhythm with the feet and a stutter step specific to that ritual practice. They say, despite the name, shouting aloud is not an essential part of the ritual. Shouting, wailing is part of the ritual. They say it was practiced in some African-American churches into the 20th century. It continues to be practiced in some today. Then it says it continues to the present among the Gullah people in the Sea Islands, which is true. But then you also have people outside of the Gullah region who still practice hoodoo and still engage in that ring shout. Now, they also say shouting often took place during or after the Christian prayer meeting or worship service. Men and women moved in a circle in a counterclockwise direction, shuffling their feet, clapping, and often spontaneously singing or praying aloud. In Jamaica and Trinidad, the shout was usually performed around a special second, often near the center of a church building. In the Sea Islands of Georgia and South Carolina, shouters formed a circle outdoors around the church building itself. They're focused on the church. We were doing this on plantations. We were doing this when we escaped from plantations. We were out in the forest and so forth. That is a major form of religious practice. In the Akan tradition, the Akon, the Akan religious ritual, and the Akon dance, moving around in that counterclockwise circle, is a major form of religious worship. The Akon, that's why it's even called Akon, the ritual practice itself. So they're focused here on the church and all of that, but we know more than that. Then, just to give you an example, when they misinform about origin, they will say the origins of the ring shout are usually assumed to be derived from African dance. Some scholars have suggested that the ritual may have originated among enslaved Muslims from West Africa as an imitation of tawaf, the mass procession around the Kaaba, that is an essential part of Islamic pilgrimage to Mecca. If so, the word shout may come from the Arabic shout, meaning a single run, such as a single circumambulation or moving around in a circuit of the Kaaba or an open space of ground for running. There could be some validity to this theory because ring shouts were practiced before conversion of slaves to Christianity. Now, of course, that is pure stupidity and it's an absolute lie, and they know it. They're always trying to gut our tradition. So whether they try to say that hoodoo is a mixture of European folk magic and Native American folk magic and African slave magic and so forth, totally inaccurate. Hoodoo has nothing to do with pseudo-Native Americans. It has nothing to do with European pseudo-folk magic. There's 100% Afurakani, African black, and it comes from the Akan tradition. The same thing is true of the Akon dance, moving around in that counterclockwise circle. We brought that exact same major form of worship, invocation of the Abosom and Nsamapo into the Western Hemisphere during the Musuo Ketsie, and we continued that process. The term, it has nothing to do with silly nonsense about Muslims going around the Kaaba. It has to do with black people moving around in a counterclockwise circle, directed by the Abosom to move in that counterclockwise circle. It is the same direction and movement that the earth, Asaseya Fua, spins upon her axis. This is why we move in that same counterclockwise circle, moving in harmony with Asaseya Fua, our earth mother. It creates a vortex of energy and a magnetism that draws the Abosom down. So we talk about Ndu, also meaning to become heavy with the spirit, and Kanche, to conjure the spirit. We're utilizing the ring shout or the Akom dance to move around in a circle. As we move around in that circle, invoking the Abosom through ritual song and clapping as well, and dance, moving around that circle creates a vortex of energy, no different than if you filled up a bathtub full of water, pulled the stopper out, and there's a whirlpool, so to speak, a whirlpool effect. There's a vortex of energy that's pulling and moving down into the stop. That whirling of energy, that whirlpool effect, that's a vortex that's beginning to draw down that water into the spot. In the same fashion, as we move in that counterclockwise circle, we begin to generate a vortex of energy. It is a gateway that is open for the Abosom, the deities, and the Nananon Instamampo, the spiritually cultivated ancestors and ancestors, to be drawn into that sacred space we just created by moving around that sacred space. And they come down and possess, so they can communicate, so they can heal us, so they can give us direction, admonition, correction, and so forth, and vision. This is what we have always been engaged in. So we know exactly what we're doing. The whites and their offspring writing foolish documents are trying to dispossess our people of our culture because they are spirits of disorder. All of them who exist, all of them who have ever existed, all of them who ever will exist until we make them extinct. They incarnate as spirits of disorder, cancerous cells in the body of black humanity. And that is true without exception. So that's the misinformation that you will constantly hear, but we need to get our information from our own sources, which is our direct experience. This is our ancestrally inherited experience. Only we can speak on this. Nobody can speak with authority on our culture except us. So we don't entertain our absolute enemies or some black people who are aping the misinformation of our enemies. So first we're going to get into some actual detailed information from a valid source dealing with the basis of the ring shout, some excerpts, and then we're going to prove how this is an Akan practice etymologically, culturally, ritually, linguistically, and so forth. So, Dr. Katrina Hazard, who we've referenced before, has published the book Mojo Working, talking about the hoodoo tradition. We always recommend that work because it's bringing out detailed information about how the hoodoo tradition came from West and Central Africa into the Western Hemisphere. There's also a specific article she published specifically dealing with the ring shout. It's called Hoodoo Religion and American Dance Traditions, Rethinking the Ring Shout. Dr. Katrina Hazard. Now, and you can download that on, you can Google that on in Google and you'll find that information. It's a lengthy article. We'll just take some specific excerpts of the relevant piece. And it's out of the Journal of Pan-African Studies. Pull up, let's look at page 'Enslaved Africans in North America allotted both temporal and physical spaces for individual expression in both circle dance and line dance formations. Within the circle formation, that space, and hold on one second. Okay. In the circle formation, let me pull back up to that specific space where we missed it. We scroll down. Okay, within the circle formation, that space was located within the circle center. In the line formation, the space was between the two lines. When an individual stepped into the allotted space, they commanded the surrounding community's attention and support. In the sacred circle, the center was a vortex of spiritual energy and power, which represented a separate and sacred realm, one not of the material realities of enslavement. It represented a reality which connected one to the ancestors and reconfirmed a continuity through both time and space. Within the circle, the interaction between the individual and the community was mediated by sacred spiritual forces evident in spirit possession. Not so with the line. The allotment of an individual space would not disappear either after the African sacred dances began to secularize or after Africans took up European secular dances, but would over time expand as the sacred circle structure gradually disappeared in most locales and the shout took up new vestments. As a result of its flexibility and successful adaptation in the secularization process and because of its similarity with the European line dance formation, the African line would remain untransformed and retain its original African formation. So she's talking about the origins of modern dance in our communities, but being rooted in these different formations in ancestral religious practice. African-American dance circle formation had an indisputable sacred identity that continued in spite of the line losing all indications of an earlier sacred existence. It was from the African sacred circle that the first truly African-American dance was born, the ring shout. The ring shout was a counterclockwise sacred circle dance that appears to have been done universally among African-American bondsmen and later freedmen. Among freedmen, the shout, as it was known, used subdued stepping and hopping footwork performed with a system of gesture, spear possession, individualized sacred dancing, specific music, particularly vocal shouting. The music accompanying the ring shout was performed by the shouters themselves. Hand claps and foot stomps provided the musical backdrop, while subtle jerking motions in the dancers' bodies provided an additional rhythmic anchor to the shout. Shouters would later add other instruments as the worship became modernized and adapted to demographic changes in the African-American population. The ring shout appeared on antebellum plantations as well as in urban areas. It frequently puzzled whites, who often viewed it with suspicion, disgust, fear, and misinterpretation. It was always performed in a sacred context that was separated by both day time and location from Sunday church services, usually midweek, in an open clearing, in the woods, in a praise house, or in a location other than that used for church service. The practice of shouting would prove to be incompatible with the internal structure of a Christian church. Its fixed pews prevented the shouters from convening the circle. It was this internal church architecture, which is often fixed, stationary, and linearly organized in pews with front-facing altar and pulpit, that contributed to the destruction of the circularity of the ring shout. And there she gives some examples of some eyewitness accounts. Frederick Law Olmsted leaves us this observation, and this is a quote, eyewitness account, on most of the large rice plantations which I have seen in this vicinity, there is a small chapel which the Negroes use as their prayer house. The owner of one of these told me that having furnished the prayer house with seats having a back rail, his Negroes petitioned him to remove it because it did not leave them room enough to pray. It was explained to me that it is their custom in social worship to work themselves up to a treat pitch of excitement in which they yell and cry aloud, and finally shriek and leap up, clapping their hands and dancing as it is done at heathen festivals. The back rail they found to seriously impede this exercise. So they were talking about, even though there were little structures built for them to engage in ritual practice at some point, they were trying to build them like churches, the whites were, on these plantations. Our people said we needed these structures to not have these pews and rails and so forth because we needed room to quote-unquote pray to engage in that ring shout. And when we engaged in that ring shout effectively, this is why they said the Europeans saw these things with disgust and fear and suspicion, because once our people became aroused through this ritual practice that led to revolution, resolution, waging war against the whites in their offspring, being empowered and guided by the Ahosom some off of the deities and ancestral spirits to kill our enemies, free ourselves from enslavement. So, unlike the Christian church, the Shout had no preacher and did not adhere to the same order of services church. So she goes into some more detail, has some more examples. A white observer leaves us this account of a Shout where a sacred circle was convened. So she quotes from one of these eyewitness accounts. Tonight I have been to a Shout which seems to me certainly the remains of some old idol worship. The Negroes sing a kind of chorus, three standing apart to lead and clap, and then all the others go shuffling round in a circle, following one another with not much regularity, turning round occasionally and bending the knees and stamping so that the whole floor swings. And I never saw anything so savage. This is what the cracker is saying. They call it a religious ceremony, but it seems more like a regular frolic to me. The cracker couldn't understand why we were moving around in a circle in a syncopated rhythm, engaging in spirit possession communication. So, and then they quote from someone, one of our own people at the particular time, a formerly enslaved African described the clandestine funeral rite and the use of the sacred circle. And they said, quote, I watch him had a funeral. I get behind the bush and hide and watch and see what they does. They doing a long procession to the burying ground, the burial ground, and they beat the drums long the way and days submit the body to the ground. Then they dance round in a ring and they motion with the hand. They sing the body to the brave, and then they let it down and they circle around in the dance. So of course they were spelling it the way they phonetically spoke it, but this is somebody who was watching a sacred ring shout dance during a funeral. So we're talking about the ring shout. They were dancing around in a circle, chanting, singing, as well as crying out, whether it's a funeral service, and sometimes when people get possessed, and those shouts become like cries or wails and so forth. This is what's happened. And then they talk about a plantation owner's daughter recalls witnessing a deathbed ritual where the counterclockwise circle was invoked among Africans who were enslaved on her father's Virginia plantation. Her room was crowded with Negroes who had come to perform their religious rites around the deathbed. This is where the wailing comes in, the lamentation, the wail. Joining savage dance, shouting wildly around her bed. This was horrible to hear and see, especially as in this family, every effort had been made to instruct their Negro dependents in the truth of religion. But although an intelligent woman, she seemed to cling to the superstitions of her race. So the cracker was so upset because they did everything they could to brainwash them with Christianity. When that funeral came and it was time to really communicate with the spirits, all the people came around the deathbed of the person. They clasped hands and they began to ring shout the Akon circle, danced around the circle, and began to invoke the Abosom and communicate with the Nsamampo and communicate with the spirit of the deceased. And all of that Christianity nonsense was thrown out the window. And then she has another quote from Congo Square, formed in circular groups in the midst of four of which I examined, but there were more of them, was a ring, the largest not 10 foot in diameter. In the first were two women dancing. They held each a coarse handkerchief extended by the corners in their hands and set to each other in the miserably dull and slow figure, hardly moving their feet or bodies. Most of the circles contained the same sort of dancers. One was larger, in which a ring of a dozen women walked by way of dancing round the music in the center. And they say walked around because when the dance is moving around in that counterclockwise circle, syncopated foot, stutter step movement, it looks like a walk and a dance and a glide all at the same time. So the whites and offspring just say, well, they're walking or they're stomping or they're shuffling around. But of course, they weren't able to engage that same kind of rhythm. Now, this is that basic information from this article, and it's a 20-page article. It's very, in depth. So talking about the basic formation of that. She also says the ring shout was imported from an intermediate religious form, the old Hoodoo religion, and early Americanization of a number of different African traditional religions. Of course, that comes later. This was an intermediate religious form that developed among North American bondsmen prior to their widespread and in-depth Christianization. It emerges from an African religion complex, a collection of eight traits held in common by an overwhelming majority of African captives imported to the U.S. and its colonies. These eight traits included: 1, counterclockwise sacred circle dancing; 2, ancestor reverence; 3, belief in spiritual cause of malady; 4, water immersion; 5, spirit possession; 6, animal sacrifice; 7, naturopathic medicine; 8, divination. So Dr. Hassard identifies those eight as the African religion complex. He saw commonalities amongst the way we practice ancestral religion here in North America, these various eight principles you find throughout. So the ring shout was an expression of that, coming out of that general African religion complex, those eight traits that make that up. What we add to that is the specific expression of the African religion complex that gave birth to Hoodoo originally, when it was first brought here, was the Akan religion complex. So now let's look at the etymology so we can prove that. Now, first of all, of course, we'll do this real quick. If you look at the etymology of a specific term, so for example, we talked about kanche. Kanche in the Akan language, ka meaning to speak, say, tell, utter sounds, che, ache, to come forth as the rising of the sun, but also bringing forth the spirit, rising up and so forth. Kan che, to utter incantation, ka, to bring forth the spirit, che. That's what we utilize the term kan che for thousands of years. Then you look at the Medutu in ancient Kemet, ka means to speak, utter incantations, pray, to tell, to say, and che means the coming forth of the sun, and the actual hieroglyphic symbol, the Medu, is the sun itself rising above the horizon. So the exact same ka, che, from ancient Kemet, meaning uttering those incantations to bring forth the spirit, like the rising of the sun, the emergence of that energy through ritual prayer. We continue to say kan, che, in Akan, and once we got into the Western Hemisphere, we continued to speak. We didn't stop speaking when we got off the boat. We hadn't learned English yet. We continued to say kanche. We continued to say undu. We continued to say aboson. We continued to say nsamanko. We continued to say hoodoo man, hoodoo woman, and so forth. We continued to say these various things. We were saying odumaso, which became oduma, and uduman, and hoodoo man, or hoodoo man in English, and so forth. But we were saying oduma people, odumani, these various things. So we continue to say these things. The whites in our spring heard us say kanche, and they knew it meant we were bringing down the spirits, and that was the name, descriptive title of our religion. So they were like, oh, they must be saying conjure with a southern accent. And instead of saying conjure, they're saying kanje and kanje. And they just assumed that we were mispronouncing an English word. In reality, we were saying the same word we've been saying for thousands of years. We proved this in our document, and we showed them the deuce of the hieroglyphs to prove that this is a not only an Akan term, but ancient Akan from ancient Kana. Therefore, it is not derived from English. We have a direct line from ancient Kana, the Medutu, the hieroglyphs, to the tree language directly into North America without any English influence at all. The same thing has to do with the term shout. Now, if you look at the term shout and you look at the etymological origin of the term shout, they'll say it's possibly, perhaps, from the root shoot, meaning to throw the voice out and so forth. They don't know the etymology. They're not sure about the etymology of shout. They're not sure. Now, in the Akan language, we have a specific term. And this is a term we were using on the continent. We'll show we were also using it in ancient Kemet. We're using the term on the continent, and we continue to use the term once we got over here. And we said we're about to go and shout That's an English term that sounded very similar to the term that we continue to say. So when the whites and their offspring heard us say that we were going to go into a ring and choke or choke, they said, oh, what they're saying is they're going to go into a ring and shout. They're mispronouncing the word shout. Now, even these English words, for example, hero, the one who saves, comes directly from ancient Kemet, Heru, the one who saves, but it's actually a deity in the whole cosmology which gives birth to the name Heru. The whites and offspring have the term, but they don't have the cosmology or the deity that gave birth to the term. The deity Amen is a great god, Amenet is a great god. They use Amen at the end of prayers, but they don't know where the term comes from. You'll find these terms all throughout the English language, as well as the various European, Indo-European languages and so forth, because the roots of these terms come directly from ancient Kemet. We showed that, for example, in War Means Dead as well. So you will find that these terms that you find in the Akan language dictionary, the Akan language as well as languages across the board, you will find thousands of years old in the hieroglyphic dictionary, the exact same words with the exact same meaning, but attached to the exact same day. In the Akan language, the term Jo, D-W-O, also spelled D-W-O-W, it has a couple of different meanings. The most important meaning with regard to here has to do with lamenting, ritual lamentation, crying out, and so forth. The related term is also Jung, or et jung, with an M at the end of it, et jung, which means song. We're talking about ritual song. Now, you have the term jo, which means to cry out, lamentation. You're talking about jo. When we engage in ritual song, we dance in a counterclockwise circle, and we begin to jo. We're going to go and jo. We're going to shout. We're going to lament. We're going to cry. We're going to invoke and so forth, jo. And we do so through the agency of Jung, with an M at the end, Jung, which means ritual song. So Jung means to cry out, lament, to wail. Jung means ritual song. So we dance in that counterclockwise circle. We engage in Jung to release those sound vibrations. The whites and offspring heard that we were going to go engage in Undu, which is hoodoo. We're going to go engage in Kanche, which misnomered conjure. We're going to go engage in Ju, which means to release those sound vibrations through chant, through cry, through song, ritual song, to invoke the Abosom, evoke the ancestresses and ancestors. Find that term in the Akan language, both of those terms in the Akan language. And Ju also means root and root, which is also key. So we're going to pull that information up real quick. You can look in the Asante Fanti dictionary, to cry aloud, Ju, or Ju, also to lament, to wail. When people in traditional Akan funerals, you have people who are designated ritual wailers, lamenters, and criers. Designated. Priests and priestesses, very often priestesses, who are designated to release that those sacred funerary wail. Just as in ancient Kemet, you will see Osset and Nebethet, and they have streams of tears projecting from their eyes. These are the two designated wailers, lamenters, the criers at the funerary bier of Osar. In the Akan tradition, you have people designated to wail during the ritual of funerary practice, the Ayie, the funerary practice. Why do they engage that process? Because they're using the wailing, the sound vibrations, to invoke the Abosom and evoke the ancestresses and ancestors, including the spirit that just separated from the body. Even if the people in the family are very distraught and they have their crying and things like that, if you have these designated ritual cry, ritual wail, ritual lamenter, and ajo, ritual cry, release those sound vibrations to provoke the energy of the Abosom and Unsamampo to draw them to us during this ritual celebration so they can comfort the people as well as bring balance to that spirit who just separated from the body because they're about to make their transition from the physical world to the ancestral realm to be settled there and so forth. So Ajo, to cry aloud, Ajo, to lament, to wail. And of course, that's the root of Ajoa, which is the title of Aset, and she's the one who cries for her husband Asar. That's Ajoa Inakan, female Abosom governing Monday Joda, Ajoa for female, and then Kwadjo for male, sometimes pronounced Kojo and so forth. But Jo meaning to wail, cry aloud, to wail, to lament. We're talking about ritual wail. Jo, releasing sound vibration. Then you also have the term Jom, D-W-O-M, Jom, which means to sing, talking about ritual song, to invoke the Abosom, to evoke the Nananong Nsma for the spiritually cultivated ancestresses and ancestors. So when we said we were going out to Jom, they said, oh, they're, and we went and did it, and they saw that we were wailing and shouting and singing and so forth. They said, oh, when they said they're going out to Joe, go out in the fields and Joe or Joe, they said, oh, they're saying show or shop. They're mispronouncing the word show. And in a southern dialect, we're going out to shout. Instead of saying shout in a northern English dialect, we're going out shouting. Or shouting, we're going out to shout. In a southern dialect, that comes from Joe. We're going out to joke. Literally, we're going out to wail, to sing, to lament, to release these sound vibrations. But here's the key. The same term, joke, and joa, also is pronounced jebwa and jeb in Akan. You have two different pronunciations, joke and jeb, and also jeba or jebe. Why is that important? Because Joa not only means to shout, sing, lament, and so forth, it also means await of or for gold, await for gold, a unit of weight to weighing gold and so forth. Let's get into the Hoodoo book. This is the key, and this ties everything together. When you look in our book, Hoodoo People, Afurakanu, Afurakaitnu, the North America Akan, custodians of Hoodoo, from ancient Hoodoo, Ndunu land, Kandik, Nubia. We show that the term Ndu means medicine in Akan, specifically from roots, trees, bark, plants, and so forth. Ndu also means medicine in ancient Kemet, and it also means trees, plants, plant life, and so forth. Exact same term. Ndu also means to become heavy, to be like a weight, heavy with the spirit specifically, heavy, a weight. That's in Akan. Undun in ancient Kemet in the Medusu means to become heavy, a weight. The exact same definition. But then Udu, when we give our Hoodoo, when we give our ritual offerings, they're called the Hoodoo. You're going to do your Hoodoo on somebody. You're going to give your Hoodoo to the spirit. You're going to make your Hoodoo and give your Hoodoo and so forth. It's an offering. You look in the language of ancient Kemet, the term undu means an offering or to make an offering. And it also means something offered, a gift. It also means the shrine, the altar itself. So it means the exact same thing in North America, functionally, because we still utilize that terminology. It means the same thing on the continent, becoming heavy undu with the spirit. Root work, root medicine from plants, trees, and so forth. Undu means the exact same thing in ancient Kemet, undu, but it also means to give your undu, to give your offer. So then we show a specific text dealing with that. I'm going to read that text, portion of the text real quick, just so you can see that. Undun, ntoro ku, sao tu erna. Betal Tuf. That is a text from ancient Kemet, from the instruction of Ani, the so-called papyrus of Bulaq 4. The translation is, when offering to the deity, to your deity, guard against that which he abominates, meaning when you're making a ritual offering to the deity, to the abosom that you're invoking, guard against offering that which he abominates. The term for offering that you're giving is undu in the Medutu, in the hieroglyph. So when we talk about in ancient Kemet, when you're giving an offering, it says when you're giving your undu, when you're giving your hudu to the untoro, to the deity, guard against giving that which he abominates. We've been saying that offerings are called hudu or undu for thousands of years. We said that in ancient Kemet. It's proven in the text. Say that in West Afuraka, Afuraikai, the undu is the medicine, the ritual offering. And in North America, we say hudu is the medicine, it's the ritual offering. And we also identify the entire religion as that because the medicine, the ritual offering is all tied together. So that's a clear piece right there. Undu meaning medicine, undu meaning offering, undu also meaning to become heavy, like a weight becoming heavy with the spirit when you engage that process of ritual offering, conjuring the spirit, they come down upon you and possess you, become heavy with the spirit. That's why undu means to conjure and so forth. Now, the reason why that's important, the offering itself, the ritual practice itself, is an offering. That's not only food offering. You can have offerings of food, you can have offerings of incense, you can have offerings of plant life, you can have offerings of energy through sacred song. That's an offering in and of itself. So sound vibration, sacred song is an offering. You're projecting energy, sound vibrations. That's a substance in reality. If someone sings very loud and the sound vibrations break a glass, that's a projection of energy, units of energy. You just gave units of energy to that glass and the glass broke. Now, what's important about that, the term undu, meaning an offering or to make an offering, to engage in a ritual practice, to go to an altar, undu, and the altar itself is also called undu. And undu also means to become heavy with the spirit, and undu also means medicine. But in this context of offering or making an offering or going to an altar to give an offering, undu, the determinative symbol for that offering is the Deben symbol. The Deben symbol has two different variations. One is an S shape, but then the other one, which is key to our discussion, is a circuit. It's a circular symbol, like a rope in a circular fashion. It's the Deben symbol. The term Deben means circle, circuit, to make the circuit of or go around the place. And that's the symbol we use for the show. The hieroglyphic symbol Medutu, to wander around a place, to go around, to make the circuit of a place, to go around, to revolve, the circuit, to circle, to circumference around about. So that exact symbol of that circuit, that circular circuit, that counterclockwise circle is the determinative symbol for undu, meaning you're giving an offering at an altar. We just talked about when they talk about the church altars, we will go around the church altars in a counterclockwise circle. Even when we weren't in the churches, we were in the fields and so forth. We have an offering in the middle. We go around that offering or that sacred natural altar in a circular fashion, counterclockwise, the exact same circuit, which is the ring, shout, circle, is shown in the Medutu as a determinative symbol indicator of the term undu in the hieroglyph, meaning giving an offering. So undu, giving an offering, going around in a circle or a circuit, that's the ritual ring, shout, and the symbol of the circuit itself, and two legs walking in the Medutu, all contained within that symbol. So we're looking at an actual representation of the ring shout in the Medutu for the term undu, meaning ritual offering at an altar. All of it coming together. The legs walking, the drawing of the circular circuit, the counterclockwise circuit and so forth, and the table or altar where the offering is being given. That's thousands of years old, and we get to West Afuraka Afraikai. We still move in that counterclockwise circle, giving those ritual offerings, being possessed, moving in that same fashion, calling it Undu, ritual medicine and so forth, becoming heavy with the spirit, Undu. And then we get to North America thousands of years later, after ancient Kanan, and hundreds later after West Afrika, Afrikaner, and we're still calling the tradition Hoodoo. We're still talking about the ring, shout, or the jo, meaning to lament, to cry out, to wail, to engage in ritual song for the purpose of spirit possession, and we're moving around in the circle. Now, that Deben symbol, and we talked about that circular symbol that's a determinative for the Hoodoo word, that has the circuit and so forth. That's also key as well, because Demben is also pronounced Djembe in ancient Kemet. What does that mean? In ancient Kemet, it means that circle, that circuit, that's the symbol for it. Djembe or Djembe, because the symbol for the D sound, the death sound, is a flat open palm. But it also interchanges with the J sound. So you found some words, for example, the term for apple is spelled with the symbol of the open palm turned up upward. That's typically a D sound. And the word for apple is Depe. But it's also written in Coptic, Chepe. So the D sound and the DJ sound, the De and the De, J, are interchangeable. Sometimes it's written with the D sound, de. Sometimes it's written with the DJ sound, je. So you have the same thing here, the depe, which is the circuit to wander around in a circle, circuit and so forth. And that symbol is used at the end of the Hoodoo word. But depe or jebe also means to beseech, to entreat, to supplicate, prayer, entreaty, prayer, and so forth. It also means propitiatory offering, jebe. But it also means that circuit or circular circuit. Why is that important? Why is the term Djembe or Djembe, meaning the circular circuit, that circle, that circuit, counterclockwise circuit, also meaning ritual offering, but also meaning to entreat, to pray, ritual invocation, Djembe, ritual invocation, Djembe, circular circuit, but then Djembe, also meaning a unit of gold or a unit of weight, like for a gold weight or a silver weight and so forth, it's a unit of weight. What is the connection between the two, or the three, actually? Djembe meaning the circuit, counterclockwise circle, the same symbol used for the circuit that we move around in ritually for. Djembe means prayer, entreaty, supplication. Djembe also means a weight, a unit of weight, as in gold itself, in the hieroglyphic dictionary. We just also showed the term jo, which means to engage in ritual song as well as ritual lamenting, ritual sound vibrations being released in the Asante Fanti dictionary, and we'll read this directly. Jo, also Jowa, it says originally Jeba or Jepe, await for gold. So jo, meaning to sing, also to lament, to wail. And jo is that shouting that we go and do when we're going around in a circle. Jo is also, or jowa, is also jeba or jebe, await of or for gold. Then you look in ancient Kemet, jebe also means await for gold, but jebe also means to pray, to entreat, to sing. And you'll find in Kemet, just like in Akan, is Jowa or Joba, and also Jeba or Jebe. In ancient Kemet is Jebe, but then there's also a spelling with this Jobe or Joba. Just like in Akan, you have Joba and Jebe, await of or for gold, but also singing, lamenting, chanting. In ancient Kemet is Joba as well as Jebe, which means await for gold or any other metal, but also chanting, singing, ritual song, ritual prayer, and also the symbol of the circuit moving around in the circle. That weight of gold is talking about the weight, not only a weight for regular gold to weigh something, a sacred metal, It's also talking about the weight, talking about becoming heavy with the spirit, or weight. That's why undu also means a weight, or become heavy with the spirit. So when we're talking about a weight for gold or a unit of weight, and it's showing that measurement of that heaviness or that substance, that's talking about when somebody gets possessed with the spirit on a mundane level, it's talking about weighing gold or weighing silver and so forth. It's talking about that heaviness and the value of that mineral that you're weighing. On a spiritual level, the heaviness comes from the deity that comes down and descends and takes up residence in your body. Your body becomes very heavy, heavy with the spirit. And the value of that force is expressed through you when it communicates with community and shows us how to heal ourselves and protect ourselves and do what we need to do. So, Jowa, meaning a weight for gold, also pronounced Jeba, meaning a weight. In the Akan language, Joba, in ancient Kemet, meaning a weight for gold, and Jeba, also variation, meaning a weight for gold, but also meaning to entreat, to pray, to supplicate, to bring down the spirit, also showing that circuit moving around in a circle. So that's all tied together. When we said Jo, we're going to Jo or Cho, later it became we're going to go and Sho, and they said, oh, they're saying they're going to Sho or shout. No, we're going to Jo, meaning to lament, to wail. Jo, meaning to cry out. Jo, meaning to engage in ritual song, to bring down the spirit, to become heavy with the spirit. So the power and value of that sacred, precious spirit, like a sacred, precious metal, gold and silver and so forth, we become weighty with that spirit. We become heavy with that spirit. We're going to Jo, meaning to sing, to lament, but also cry out, engage in ritual song. And we're going to move in a counterclockwise circle. And this is why Jo and Joba, as well as Jeba in Akan, means the exact same thing in ancient Kemet, Joba or Jeba, which is the circular circuit that's drawn as a symbol for hoodoo in the Medusa, in the language. We have the entire complex woven into the Medusa. You have the walking leg. You have the symbol of the circular structure. You have the term meaning to entreat, to pray, to supplicate, moving around in a circle, to become possessed and become heavy with the spirit while you're giving that sacred ritual offering. All of that is tied into the term Jo in Jun, in Akan, and in the ritual practice in Hoodoo. It's also tied into the way it's spelled and its actual definition in ancient Kemet with the icons to show that, with the ideograms to show that. So, one second, we want to get over to chat room right quick. Okay, so that's the key to that information. We wanted to show that specific. Just want to pull up one more thing real quick, make sure we didn't miss that section in the Hoodoo book. Okay. Yeah, so that's the section we want to get. We just want to make sure we didn't miss that section. There is another longer quote on page 20, and it talks about the sanctuary of the deity. Basically, the text from specifically, pull it up real quick. All right. So in the text from Kemet, it says, the sanctuary of the deity or the abosom detests too much idol speaking in its shrine or sanctuary. Make your prayers, invocations with a heart which is loving or lawful, whose invocations are internal and not boastful. The deity will attend to the work you are doing ritually, hear that which you have inquired about, and accept your offering. This is in the text from ancient Kemet, specifically, and we read one of those texts. This is another section. But in the actual translation, in the terms, when it says, bringing your offerings and the deity will accept your offering, Abosom will attend to the work you are doing ritually, hear that which you have inquired about, and accept your offering. the term for offerings, once again, in the hieroglyphic text is Ndunu or Ndu. That means the deity, the Ntoro, will accept your Ndu, will accept your Hudu when you pray in a lawful fashion and not in a boastful fashion, in a silly, self-destructive, childish fashion. When you're serious about aligning with the divinity in the sanctuary of the Abosom, then when you make your offerings, meaning when you make your Ndu, then the deity will accept your Ndu or your Hudu. That's in the text of ancient commandments. So all these things are tied together. So whether we have Kanche, which is the term conjure, Ndu, which is Hudu, Hinti, which is means the aroused spirit, the Hink, the spirit, whether we have the Moja and Edja, which becomes Mojo and Ja, ritual talismans from the Matric clan and Patric clan deities and ancestral spirits of specific blood circles. And we also have this Joe. We're going down to Joe, moving in a counterclockwise circle, becoming possessed, creating that vortex of energy, the major form of our Khan ancestral religious worship to this day on the continent. You go to some ritual on the continent where our Khan people are, you go outside, you're going to see them dancing around in a counterclockwise circle, people becoming possessed, the same syncopated rhythm with the feet, stutter step rhythm with the feet, same clapping, call and response, the exact same Hudu tradition there you will see here in the Western Hemisphere. If in the language we maintain the name of it, the Joe session or the Joe practice, became mispronounced as Sho or Shoten practice or Shouten practice, but it's the Joe, the Joa. And the whites in our offspring heard us saying Joe or Joa, and they were like, oh, they must be saying Shoa or Shout, and this is what they're doing, because they're lamenting and shouting and praising and engaging in this kind of activity. So you can get detailed information on that in our Hudu People publication. That is one of our 21 books. This feed out this past Friday at the Ojiramana Fashe Conference, we released our 21st book, the Ojiramana Fashe Nhoma, or book. Detailed information about Amanie, nationism, the purification of nationalism. We also published our Per Ankh Newt and Uben and the behavioral cycle, so the presentation that we did on that, which is part of our Afra Whole Life Intervention Therapeutic Model, where we show that how that ancestral religious cosmogram regulates every aspect of our lives, including as a nation, as a collective, and how it's directly related to regulating our activities as Ojiramana, the purified nation, Afrakani, Afrakani, people in the Western Hemisphere, in a harmonious fashion. 21st book, what we did was we released the soft cover version at the event. We gave a free copy to everyone who came out to the event. And for those who came in a little bit later, we had our first annual Ojiramana Fashe Ojiramana conference. Ojiramana is a purified Ojira nation, a mind, in the Western Hemisphere, Omind, Ojiramana, the purified nation, Afurakani, Afurakani, people in the Western Hemisphere. We had our first conference. The focus is Amanie, nationism, Afurakani, Afurakani, or African Black nationism, the purification of nationalism. So we went into detail about that. That was what the conference was about. We had presenters. We had vendors all day, of course. Great presentations, great exchanges of information and energy from the audience and so forth. So we're going to be publishing and releasing the video clips that we have from the conference. We're going to post that on our page, YouTube page, as well as our regular website page and Facebook and so forth. So that'll be coming up this week. That information will be out. We released the ebook version of the publication on yesterday. So now the ebook version is out and the soft cover version is out. Soft cover version is $9. The ebook version, of course, is a free download. So we have 21 books out now. All 21 books are free downloads from our website. But then we also publish the soft cover versions of our books. We print our own books in-house on our own printers in color. We do not contract that out. We're totally self-contained. All of our books range between 8 and $11. Most of them are $9 or $10. So if you'd like to support the work that we are doing, and that support supports our institution, supports our entrepreneurship program, supports these free conferences and presentations that we do in different cities. If you'd like to support the work we're doing, you can order the new book, Ojira Mana Fashe, for $9, or any of the other 20 books. And then we have discounts for any orders of 10 books or more. It's automatically 30% off. So the first 10 books are $66 for 10 books. We have 20% off for the first 5 books. So it's 5 books for $40. So you can go to the Nhoma page, the publications page on our website, and download the free books, as well as if you'd like to support the work that we are doing, you can publish one or more of the, or purchase one or more of the books, and that supports the work we're doing. So we're going to get on the phone line right quick. We have a call on the phone line. Yeah, we're on the phone line. You had a question or a comment, number 9734.
Oh, tip.
What's up?
What's up? I'm just making sure you can hear me clearly. Yeah, I got a comment. No question. I'm just really listening to everything you're saying this evening. And it's probably a comment that's probably more in line with the theme of tomorrow's broadcast, if you're gonna have one tomorrow. But what I want to comment on is what I seen realize, and I can be wrong, you know, but I think within the as you would put it, the ancestral religious community, I think we have some individuals that's in the community that are doing things for fashion, and not because they really are seriously concerned about, you know, being sovereign, being free, being independent. You know, so that's, you know, part of the comment. You know, a lot of the people in the community are just there, you know, for fashion and not because, you know, they are seriously concerned, you know what I mean? And also, I think we got a lot of egomaniacs in, you know, our communities as well. People who are very unreceptive to the insights and opinions and sentiments of a lot of people in our community, as if, you know, everything that those the individual, certain individuals are supposed to be a part of our community have to say, or like, you know, like certain people in the community are beneath them. And, you know, I think, you know, when we engage in purification, it, and we go through the ritual purification consistently, we move, like, because I can be wrong in this assessment, but innocence, to a degree, is synonymous with purification, because when you become pure, you become more in tune and to a degree innocent and pure. You can see the relation with those terms. And with that degree of innocence and with that degree of purity that one develops or get closer to, they also develop a heightened sense of sensitivity, just like a child, because, like, you know, most people, you know, in their youth or in their childhood, in their state of being more pure or innocent, they're more receptive to the spiritual realm. They're more receptive to hearing from the Nananuma, Samafuni, Abosun. So as some of us grow closer to that state, we become more innocent, more pure, more receptive, more sensitive to inconsistencies. And I think there's a lot of people in our community that, like I said earlier, who are just doing what we are trying to do for fashion, and they are borderlining on being egomaniacs. So that's like, you know, my comment, part of my my comment, and because a lot of the people are still seriously attached to the Achiwadifu, to the whites and their offspring, in this system of governance, the system of economics, et cetera, et cetera, and unwilling to sever the ties in so many ways to be, because you go back, and I go cut the show, I don't be too long and keep the show up too long. If you go back to Afureka, the mother continent, Africa, we go back when our ancestors heard and received, you know what I mean, the teachings, the lessons, or, you know, instructions from spirit forces and nature. They didn't have all the technology that we have. They didn't have water being pumped to them by somebody else. They didn't go to grocery store. So they were in a state of heightened receptivity. They were in a state where they had to lean solely on the Ntoru and Ntoru for assistance and guidance. And a lot of our people are so comfortable with somebody else doing something for them, they are not going to be able to receive the instructions or the guidance or go into the state of possession. You know what I mean? So that's my comment. Like I say, I'm not an expert, but that's just what I feel. What I feel could be incorrect, but that's just my comment, bro.
Oh, no, we appreciate that. We appreciate the call. And that's good information. As a matter of fact, when we talk about Awusi or Al-Sar, Awusi and Akan is one of the titles, and even Awusi and Akan means sudden death. Awusi meaning the Abosom that govern Sunday, Awusi. When you look at one of his titles is Wab, which means pure, purified. Now, he's mummified, but that purification in reality is the knocking away or removing of debris. So when the brother was talking about on the call, he was talking about once people become purified, becoming more innocent and becoming more receptive by virtue of that innocence, that's accurate, because what you're doing is you're really the purification, your kayet is pure in and of itself. So it can't be corrupted. Now, you can build some debris around your car just like someone's buried and they're buried in soil. But the body is preserved because we had that mummification process where we preserve the bodies to the extent that they were impervious to decay. So, however, someone can be buried in a place that's not sacred. But then at some point you knock away all of the debris and then that body can be resurrected and then the actual ancestral mummified figure can rise up and become a shrine, a crystallized shrine for the community and so forth. So it was pure, but it was covered up by dirt and debris. Once you knock the debris away, now you can be raised up. That pure one, the Wab, the pure one, the title of Asar Awusi, he rises up, he's resurrected and so forth. Now his energy, like a crystal, can be, the body, of course, becomes hardened, crystallized, but then once it becomes crystallized, it becomes a shrine, a very potent shrine for the ancestral spirit, the people residents in that body, but also when people go in for libation at that specific space, then it's a shrine for them as well. It's the most potent kind of ancestral shrine you can have, which is why we mummify the body in the first place. But that purification process is the removing of debris, so you're no longer neglectful and you have a direct line, a direct clear line to the Nsamampo, to the Abosom, and so forth. And when you don't have that debris around you because you've cleared it away, you've allowed your purity to manifest. that purity that was deep within the recesses of that darkness and that, you know, debris now can fully shine and so forth. When the debris is gone, then you don't have any hindrances. You don't have anything blocking you, that nothing blocking your eyes, nose, mouth, ears. And they talk about opening of the eyes and opening of the mouth so I can speak, and opening the nose so I can breathe, and opening the ears so I can hear, and all of that. Now the person is pure, they're innocent, and they're more receptive. It's clean. It's not being blocked by, you know, other discarnate spirits and things like that. You're repelling those, and you're only receptive to those spirits of war. So yes, everything, you know, all of that is accurate, is right on point. And when people get to that point, because they're simply engaged in purification, when we say, oh, Jida, purification operationalizes Nanasong, that purification or that debris includes those conditioning, and those conditionings that have been forced upon us by this society. We engage Maranechi, divine law, love, and divine hate. We accept that which is orderly from our Umsamanfa, from our Kra, from the Abosong, and we reject, we repel, we hate, we repulse, hate, repulse, that which is disordered. That includes all those various conditioning, those superimpositions upon our thought processes. When you have superimpositions upon your thought processes, you're no longer, quote-unquote, innocent, because something else is controlling you and hovering above you and directing your movements and your thoughts and your everything else. But when you remove that debris, then you can have that clear, you know, line to the Kra, to the Abosom, to the Nsamafo. That includes people who become innocent or pure, and they don't have this desire to be narcissistic. They don't have a desire to be megalomaniac. They don't have a desire to be, you know, self-destructive or idiotic or ego-driven. All of that is clown nonsense. That's self-destructive, idiotic, childish nonsense. Some people try to call it confidence, but it's not confidence, it's just pure stupidity. It's childish. Childishness in the negative sense, not in the pure sense. When you get to the, you know, purity, like a child, like you said, all those conditionings are wiped away. They're brushed away, just like somebody brushing away sand and, you know, doing some excavation and finding a statue of Taharka that was buried for 5,000 years or really 2,700 years. And they finally bring that up after, you know, knocking that debris away. That's that conditioning being knocked away in the pureness or the innocence or the purity of, or the cleanliness of the Kra, where the Kra begins to shine forth. So yes, people become more intense in their spiritual, you know, communication, becomes intensified because there is no hindrance. It's no different than if you have a strong signal on your TV or your cell phone, because there's nothing blocking the airwaves and so forth. You're not like driving under an underpass that causes a you know, brief block of the transmission. When you're out in the open air, there's no clouds in the sky, it's not raining and anything, you have direct open access, then those signals become very clear, very sharp, very intense. You become very receptive, and that's the innocence you need, that purity you need, so you can receive that information, incorporate it, and then utilize it to execute your function and destroy those purveyors of disorder in, you know, in short order. So yeah, we appreciate that. Okay, so we have another call on the phone line. Ichiobo on the phone line, number 4836. Do you have a question or a comment?
Catch up, Kwesi.
What's up?
Yeah, man. Well, I guess my question is a little bit off topic, but feel kind of bad, man. Ever since that historic speech last night, I've been going pretty hard on, bruh, about how it's bullshit, and now my entire Facebook community is upset with me because I'm like the only Afurakani that's not still in this Jesse Williams shit. And I was wondering, what's your take on this whole situation with that speech and all this uplifting, whatever's supposed to be going on right now? I feel like Hollywood and the media is trying to absorb our conscious movement, basically. I feel like they're trying to absorb it manipulated and mediated. I don't trust anything in Hollywood, directors, none of that bullshit. So I'm trying to figure out, am I tripping or is it, do I have some kind of, you know, am I not tripping basically?
Right. Right. So, I actually did see that posted on Facebook because I hadn't paid attention. I didn't know anything about what was happening because I don't,
right.
You know, I don't watch those things. Then I kept
right,
seeing a whole lot.
I saw it after the fact.
Yeah, so a lot of people were posting something, and at some point, I decided to watch the couple of minutes that, you know, he did the thing. So you're correct. The general principle is the whites and their offspring, when they see a movement towards people awakening in a real sense, they always seek to co-opt it and misdirect it to support the whites and their offspring, to support interracialism, to support sexuality, to support everything that is self-destructive in our community. So they always seek to co-opt and redirect. So if consciousness is about embracing order, and order
right.
is comprised of divine law or love, the male and female forces of divine law, is ma'ah and ma'at, the male and female divinity, the expansive pole of order, and the contractive pole of order is Benai, Abinah, Heru, Behudet, and Sachibah, which is divine hate. Consciousness is about embracing order, which is divine law, love, and divine hate. People are not talking about divine law, love, and divine hate. They're not talking about anything conscious. So if they're not embracing divine hate, that means including all the whites and their offspring, whoever exists, whoever will exist, and have ever existed, who exist now, not embracing that reality, then they're not promoting anything that is conscious. So we have to give a proper definition of what conscious is, being in alignment with
right.
reality. And reality is expansive and contractive. It is the order that regulates creation, that is manifest through Ma'al, Ma'at on one side, Rubekudet and Sechima on the other side. That is the specific arrangement, Nyamewa, Nyame, and Sheshe, the arrangement of all the created entities in creation. If we get in harmony with that, we're conscious. If we're out of harmony with that, we're unconscious. So when we start moving
yeah.
towards that consciousness and embracing divine law, love, and divine hate, whites and offspring don't want us to embrace that because that means we will see them for exactly who they are and we'll seek to eradicate them. So they have to redirect it. So our people who are conditioned, the vast majority of our people have no knowledge on the surface level of what is real, what is conscious, what is intelligent, what is important. So when they hear a couple of little lines, they get excited about it because they're not used to hearing anything. They're watching reality TV, and they're going to church and praying to a crack on the wall and all kinds of stuff. So when on one hand we get attacked and oppressed and see our people getting killed on camera like Eric Garner and everything else, nobody likes to be attacked. Somebody on a plantation seeing someone else being attacked, they don't like to see that. You know what I'm saying? So they would stand up against that. They're against their own people being attacked and tortured and whipped and beaten and killed and everything and maimed and everything else and dismembered and everything else. But you have two different groups who are on the plantation. You have those who say, I don't like being attacked. I don't like being tortured. I don't like our people being maimed, whipped, beaten, and everything else, and killed. Let's kill the whites in our offspring, kill every one of them who exists, burn down this plantation, and free ourselves. Then you have another group on the plantation who says, I don't like seeing our people whipped, tortured, beaten. I hate that. It disgusts me. Why does it have to be this way? Let us get together and petition the slave master and show him that he's wrong. And therefore, if we can show him his immorality, maybe he will give us a better position on the plantation. They both started out hating the treatment that they were receiving. One has a proper response, is to exterminate the cracker. And the other one is too fearful to exterminate the cracker. So they're figuring out a way that we can all live together with the cracker. But they both start off hating
it's
the
like,
oppression.
It's like they want to be pacified. You know what I mean? It's like all it takes is for somebody to get up and do a speech, and now everybody's just calm. as if the Black Lives Matter struggle is over. He made a movie about some shit that's still going on. This shit's not over with. But everybody's pacified now because he got up there and said something nice about women and said something about the whole struggle. I mean, it's frustrating. It's a farce.
And the key is the context. So for example, if someone did a snapshot of the people on the plantation who said, I don't like this treatment that they're receiving, everything they said up to that point was 100% on point. If they just showed that part of their speech, they would be correct.
Mm-hmm.
But if they showed the full context, what their solution was to go to the slave master and try to become part of the plantation on a higher level, then they would realize, mm-hmm. well, these Negroes really don't want to get free. They just want to have a more comfortable position in slavery. Then they show the other
right.
group, who said at first the exact same thing, we don't like the oppression, everybody's down with it, but then their solution in full context is to exterminate the cracker, which is the same, which we all should have that solution. Then they have a full context. When somebody like him gets up and makes certain statements, certain things are accurate, but people are looking at those that string of statements. But look at the full
right.
context, then it all falls apart because the first thing he does is thanks his quote-unquote mother and father, and his mother's a
right.
cracker, and the father's
right.
a Negro married to a cracker. So it was all over
right.
from that point. You didn't need to listen to anything else after that. We knew right
okay.
from the gate, at the end of the day, he's promoting interracialism, and I'm sure absolutely promoting dissexuality, homosexuality, of course, playing on the warped consciousness of our people who worship the white and offspring and pray to a white Jesus. So since he's light-skinned with light eyes and so forth, that's part of that Messiah complex that
right.
they're drawn
now,
to.
Right.
All
now, he's the image of the movement now instead of the kids that lost their lives. It should be their faces on these walls everywhere, but now it's him. You feel me? It's bullshit, man. Ooh, it's bullshit. Bullshit, man.
It's the M.O. of the cracker. Just like with somebody like
right.
Beyonce, they
right.
like the dance and the formation and Kendrick Lamar and all that kind of thing. And when she did her thing at the Super Bowl and all that. But if you step back and look at the context, she may have played a little Malcolm X. She may have said we need to get information or information as well as the word information and, you know, play on words and things like that. But when you step back and look at the context and pan the camera and show the whole stadium, they had color-coded the entire stadium, all the seats in the stadium with the quote-unquote colors of the rainbow, and it was representing LGBT rights. All the seats in the stadium were lit up in the rainbow colors while she was doing her thing. So she was dancing in the midst of promoting quote-unquote equal rights for all people, meaning promoting dissexuality. At the end of the day, that's all it was.
Basically.
So,
at the end of the day, that's all it's about, yeah.
That's what the context is.
Well, thank you, man, because I got my family upset with me. People are really mad at me. I mean, I knew I wasn't tripping the whole time. I need a verification, man. Holler at one of my elders and really see how you feel about it, because I already know, man. It's a sham, but everybody around me, nobody sees white people as the enemy, and that's the problem with, like, 90% of niggas around the world today. They don't see white people for what they are. They are our enemies, and that's the bottom line. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. For I don't know how many thousands of years now, they've been doing everything they can to keep us away from the truth about our spirit, our connection to Inyame and Yamewa, Ra, Raet, everything. They keep it all a secret from us. And now we're waking up, and they're trying to do everything they can to absorb it and manipulate it and change it. And I'm not standing for that shit, man. I'm not about to let that happen to me or anybody else around me, because it's that time is over with, man. That time of being lost behind this veil and blind, it's over with, man. The shit needs to stop today, on today.
Absolutely. We appreciate
it.
Appreciate the call.
Thank you.
All right. So, yeah. So, and in fact, somebody brought that up. Similar sentiment about, you know, our people just around the country, around the world, still seeking to humanize in reality the white and offspring. Deep down inside, we have to recognize and remember every one of our people has a crop. Krawa and their Krawa, as well as the Abosom, the Isimampo, remind them on a daily basis that the white and offspring are spirits of disorder without exception. So they know that they're the enemy, but they fear embracing that reality. So they're always seeking to suppress that. It wells up within them, and then they try to suppress it. And then they get all the excuses that they learned from this culture to try to suppress and say that's the wrong way to think. And they try to project that suppression that they're engaged in upon themselves internally and try to project that on the rest of the black population so that they're not the only ones feeling like they're going through this dilemma. And they're trying to make everybody else participate in this foolish, self-destructive suppression of reality that they're going through. And it's a psychological disturbance, which is, you know, put forward by the white scenario frame. This is the MO. But our people know deep down within that these spirits of disorder are spirits of disorder because they experience it at work. They experience it when they interface with them. Even the ones who claim to have, you know, their great white friends and everything else, when specific issues jump off, there's a great separation. And they seek to suppress that, overlook it, do anything they can to overlook it, even if it comes to drinking and smoking weed and anything else, and try to suppress the reality because they've been conditioned to fear if you embrace the reality, then you have the responsibility to confront the reality and correct it. And they fear that confrontation because they know it has to do with physical confrontation. Ultimately, it's going to be us or them. And they fear that confrontation, so they're always trying to avoid that confrontation. So therefore, they come up with all kinds of psychological defense mechanisms to not embrace that reality. So they go all the way to the other extreme, trying to humanize the spirits of disorder and try to make them orderly when they know deep down inside they are not, even to the point where they'll cut themselves off from family, friends, other individuals, engage in all kinds of self-destructive behavior, everything else, just to overcome that. But the key is they know deep down inside. So when we speak these words, or they listen to these words and so forth, they can try to pretend like they're arguing, but once Facebook is shut down, once they leave the presence of the people they were arguing with, at some point they're alone. And those words are resonating within them, and the images that we put forward are resonating within them. We say the whites and offspring are spirits of disorder, every one of them who exists, every one of them who has ever existed, every one of them who ever will exist until we make them extinct. When they hear us say that, they cannot unhear that. Once it's heard, it's over, and it's in their spirit. It's been embedded within their spirit. They cannot unhear. They cannot unsee. It's with them for the rest of their lives. And every time they try to put forward an excuse, they remember, and it resonates within them what we place within them. And then their own insamampo and the avosom pressure them from inside as well to that validates what we put forward and what other people put forward sharing the same message. So they're in constant conflict after this information is released and forced into their consciousness, not just subconscious, but when we put this information out and they come in contact with it and they get mad and start arguing and everything else, you don't have to engage them with the argument. You put the information out. Once they see it and hear it, they get angry because they know it's too late. It's already inside their consciousness and they can't release it. So now they're fighting back because they're angry. They're swinging wildly and with great inaccuracy and so forth because they're upset that you expose the fact that they have to start at some point confronting reality. So we disturb people when we give them the truth. And that's exactly what we should be doing. And that we move on and give the people who actually want the truth, we give them the truth as well. So, okay, so we have a couple of minutes left in the broadcast. And we won't really have to go into overtime. If you want to listen beyond 11:30, you can call at number 657-383-0635, 657-383-0635. You have to call in before 11:30, so once it cuts off at 11:30 online, anybody on the phone line will still be able to hear. But we don't really have to go beyond 11:30. We only have one phone call left. We're going to take this call. Michelle on the phone line, number 9384. You got a question or a comment?
Yeah. How you doing, first of all, Kwesi? I was thinking when you were, referencing, how it was basically always divided with those who wish to rebel and those who want to just, fall in line with slave masters' orders or whatever. Why does it always seem like we're the minority? Like, you know, the ones who fight for order? Why does it seem like we're always, like, outnumbered by them? Why does it seem like there's more cowards than warriors?
It's because we are outnumbered by them. It don't seem like that. That's it. But it's,
I mean,
all right in the school, because, unlike we mentioned, like we were talking about at the conference, with regard, so for example, the 14 major systems in the body, respiratory and circulatory and integumentary and digestive and excretory,
right,
and endocrine system and musculoskeletal,
right,
system and all the different systems, it's the,
mm-hmm,
immune and lymphatic system, two out of 14 or one out of seven, who wage war,
right,
against the cancer cells. They are in the minority, the ones who are going to direct,
right,
that warfare, and then the other systems support in their different ways, but they are outnumbered. But it's all right, because that's,
mm-hmm,
by design. It was never supposed,
mm-hmm,
to be that 100% of people will be waging war against the enemy. It would be the small percentage who participate in that fight. But because of the work of the small percentage, because of the work of your immune and lymphatic system, then the rest of your body benefits from that. So they are the ones who maintain order within the system. So, yes, we are outnumbered. On one hand, because,
right,
of the conditioning, so we're a little,
mm-hmm,
bit more outnumbered than normal. But even if we were all normal, we would still be outnumbered, so to speak. The only difference is that people would be constantly respecting and valuing our position in the great divine body, so they would support that work that we have to do.
Right. Right. Okay. I understand.
Yeah.
Now, hold on. You know what? I was thinking while you were saying that, while you were explaining that. That makes sense. But now, say I wanted to know something. Okay, for instance, like, you know, the process of bringing an ancestor or an ancestor back through copulation. Now, you couldn't, like, let me see. What am I trying? Okay. You couldn't use that to petition Namewa for, like, a divine killer, like, purposely? Like, intentionally try to bring that type of Okra through the portal?
Now, you said could use what? You said use what,
like,
to bring them back?
Like, ritual sex, like, to petition, like, I don't know, something. Like, couldn't we, like, we pray, we ask for everything else? Like, we couldn't start to, like, I guess, ask for, like, specifically what type of, like, okras that we want to bring down to earth?
Okay, I see what you're saying. So, in a sense, that does happen, but it's a little bit different. So, people go through their life cycle. They engage in various behaviors. They live for however many years,
mm-hmm,
they live. And based,
mm-hmm,
on the things that they have done, some people, you know, they fulfill their function in creation. They live to a, you know, age of elder,
mm-hmm,
elders, and so forth, make that transition. Some people do not. They may get killed or something, or they were doing something crazy, or, you know, leave here earlier than they would have if they had listened to their own crop. Different things happen,
yeah,
that, you know, put people in a position where they transition at the specific time that they do. And then they go into the,
mm-hmm,
you know, Mando, the ancestral realm. They're there for however long they need to be there based on what they have done in the physical world, as well as what they have done since they transitioned.
Right.
So then you have a number of people, either in your blood circle or the blood circle of the female, who are ready to return. Now,
right,
you're not going to be able to bring all of them back. It may be, you know, 30 of them, unless you're trying to have 30 kids. You know what I'm saying? But if you're not trying to do that, you're not,
mm-hmm,
going to bring them all back. But there are some that can be repelled from the womb,
right,
space, and some that can be open, that you can be open to, based on what you're doing. And in that sense,
right,
you're like, yes, quote unquote, petitioning. You're engaged in ritual purification. You're aligning with your car on a consistent basis, and so is the wife, and so forth. Then the kind,
right,
of spirit that you bring in from your ancestry is the kind who is in alignment with that kind of function, and they did that kind of work themselves, and they were previously on earth as well in the spirit realm. But if you had two people who are, you know, criminals or engaged in drug use or rapists or something like that, or, you know, somebody engaged in interracialism and all that, they'll draw some negative spirit in or some weak spirit in, or somebody who is engaged in the same kind of low-level frequency kind of stuff that they're doing, and they'll bring one of those people back.
Right.
But yes, through our, on one hand, there are certain ones who are ready to return, but you can quote-unquote negotiate or determine who's coming back through you, because there'll be some who are ready to come back through you. All of them can't come back at the same time, so based on the kind of work you do, you create a vessel and a draw with that kind of spirit on the same frequency to draw them back into the world.
Right.
Right. So so basically you would suggest a married couple, to be working with their okra intensely before they engage in that practice?
Well, that just because, number one, you want to be, of course, on point, because you're bringing an ancestor or ancestors back in the world once they get here.
Anyway,
of course, they're going to be in the body of an infant, so they won't know what they need to be doing, and you have to guide them to their own cry, you know, for a number of years until they can get to the point where they can align themselves. So definitely that responsibility. Yes, you're engaging the okra on a regular basis, as well as insamampo, to make sure you're doing what you need to do health-wise and otherwise.
Okay.
But in the process, you're purifying yourself on a consistent basis. You're constantly purifying yourself, rejecting negative individuals, negative discarnate spirits as well, if they were anywhere in the vicinity, so that you open a gateway for the kind of ancestor or ancestress who's on that same frequency to be drawn in, as opposed to if you weren't on that path, you draw in the kind that maybe was a criminal, maybe was a, you know, a thief, or, you know, whatever else. And you bring some drama back into the womb and back into the world. Now, you may be able to, you know, fix that. You may be able to work with them intensely, and as they're growing up, go through a great deal of drama until you help them turn around, which is, that can happen.
Right.
As far as an optimal birth, you purifying yourself, the wife purifying herself, you're bringing about the fact of kind of creating a kind of environment that a spiritually cultivated ancestor or ancestress will be drawn into. That's what you're working on.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Made out there. Appreciate the call. Yeah, so there was a question about the ink thing. So, yes, we sent one of those notifications we sent out. We were waiting on an ink shipment. We did get an ink shipment, so that's a question in the chat room. So, yes, we did start. We got it, and then we started reprinting again. We had to wait a few extra days for that ink shipment to come in, and we did that. So if yours is one of the ones, we did send that out, as a matter of fact, yesterday, so you should have a tracking number. We sent the tracking number to your email. If I believe one of yours was one of the orders that we had to send out. It was like three of them we had to send out, back ordered a couple of days. Okay, yeah. So, yes, that was yesterday, but there's a specific post office that's open on Sundays here in D.C. that we go to sometimes, and we sent yours out with the other order. So, yeah. We couldn't send it out on Friday because of everything that was happening at the conference. We didn't get a chance to, so we did it on that special Sunday. We were able to send that out. So, and the question is, for the other listeners, sometimes we print on demand. Sometimes we ship right away because we have books in inventory. Sometimes we print on demand. So when you're printing, like some people publish their books via online publishing, like Lulu.com or CreateSpace, Amazon.com, or some of the other options. So that can be a good option because even though they take, so if you publish a book and you don't have the printing and so forth, and you don't have that kind of apparatus, then you can go through online publishing, like CreateSpace on Amazon or Lulu.com, and all you do is send your book to them, the PDF version or whatever, send what you want on the cover and everything, and they will put it together, format it, put the cover, print it out, and so forth. When people order the book on your account at Lulu.com or CreateSpace, then they ship it out to the people. You don't have to worry about shipping or printing or anything like that. People order directly through them, and they send out the book. You don't have to deal with any of that. They do take a sizable cut, you know, from the, you know, a percentage from the sale. Depending on the book, they may take, I don't know if it's 20 or 30% or 40% or something like that from the retail price, because they're printing and doing all of that. So that's one option for people who don't have, you know, the capacity to print and all of that. What we do is we print all of our books. We have printers, oversized printers. We print in color. We print on our own printers, and we do all the printing and shipping and so forth. Sometimes we do have inventory so we can ship right away. Sometimes, to be cost-effective, if we don't have the inventory, somebody orders, so we may order the ink that same day. We get the ink a couple of days later, because we have to order online because of the kind of ink that we use. And then once we get it in a couple of days, then we, you know, print, and then we ship. So it may take two extra days. One time we had to go to a different printer, a couple of times go to a different ink supplier because the one that we normally use, as a matter of fact, recently, the one that we normally would use, they were out of all the kind of ink we needed for the next week, so we had to go to a totally different supplier, push it back a couple of days. But sometimes when you're doing it like that, it's more cost effective to print on demand. So if you're thinking about publishing a book, you can do it yourself and do the printing yourself and so forth, or you can go through the option of the online printing. Just know they'll take a little bit more of a percentage typically, but then at the same time, they're doing the shipping and so forth, so you just have to weigh those different options. Okay. Yeah, so what we did was we sent the tracking information through PayPal. So there's whatever email you had through PayPal, we sent the tracking information through that. Okay. Just want to make sure we didn't miss anything in the chat room. End of here. So Yedal said we thank you for tuning in to the broadcast. Again, if you support the work we are doing, please go to the Nhoma page, the publications page. You can download the new book we just released on FIDA on Friday, the soft cover version on Friday, Ojiramana Fashe Amaniye, Nationism, the Purification of Nationalism. We're going to be releasing clips from the videos from the presentation throughout this week. We will be posting the next event coming up. So the next conference that we will have is October, where we have events every month. We've had an event once a month, every month since October in the D.C. area. But then we also do presentations in other cities. But we do have at least one presentation per month in the D.C., in the district in Washington, D.C. So we'll be letting you know what weekend in July we're going to have an event here in D.C. But we will probably also be out in a couple of different cities in July coming up, and we'll confirm that and let you know exactly where we're going to be. If you would like for us to come to your region, simply send us an email, whether it's via Facebook or our regular website, og.fo.com. We'll let you know if we have something scheduled in your city or if we want to schedule something in your city to do a presentation in your city or one of the many books that we speak upon. Whenever we do a presentation, we do not charge admissions fee for people to come to our presentation. Everybody, the opens only Afro-Akani people only, of course. You come to the presentation for free, and we give away a free copy of one of our soft cover books to everyone who attends. We have given away now over 900 books for free to the community around the country at our various events. We gave away a number of those books, as we said, this past Feed Out Friday. Printing of that book, we finished publishing the book on Thursday night, as a matter of fact, and we started printing them in by Friday morning. We had them ready, so once we went to the event, we were able to give away a free copy to everybody who came out. We've given away over 900 books, and we're going to keep that program going. So every time we do a presentation, we do that in every city. So if you would like for us to come to your city, we do not charge a speaker's fee for organizers of events. We don't charge an admissions fee for people who come to the events, and people get a free book when they leave. Now, with whether they have funds or not. We also have our Noquatifo entrepreneurship option. If you would like to sell the soft cover versions of our books to generate income for yourself as an independent entrepreneur, we have that option. So simply go to the publications page and you will see that on the page. You'll see the video for the Noquatifo distributor information document, the distributor option video as well. And you can start that process immediately, notwithstanding your prior work history. You can begin selling the book. And you also see our fundraiser for our institution. We're seeking to open a permanent space for our institution so we can expand our publishing operation and employ people within the community. In addition to the entrepreneurship option, we also have classes. We'll be doing the broadcasting from the institution, but we'll have expanded class offerings and trainings and workshops and so forth, including the Oberima Afrakani Manhood workshop based on our book, Oberima Afrakani Manhood, and various trainings that we've been doing for a while, including the social services, human service agents, Afra Whole Life Intervention Therapeutic Model Training. So we have a number of different things. So again, Yerase, we thank you for tuning into the broadcast, and Yebeshabio, we will meet again. That's it.